So, good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, everyone. Welcome to the ICME-14 Early Career Researcher Day workshop session. Workshop one, qualitative research methodology. I'm Sophie, a postdoc research fellow at Asian Center for Mathematics Education from East China Normal University. So it's a great honor for me to be the chair of this workshop. First and foremost, I want to share a greeting notes from our ECRD program chair, Professor Liang Huofan. So hello everyone. I just want to say three things in a minute. First, as a program chair, I extend a very warm welcome to each and every one of all the presenters and the participants online and on-site. Second, I want to express my appreciation to my organization team members and members of the ICME-14 Advisory Committee, as well as many other people who have helped in a lot of ways. And finally, I hope that everyone will enjoy today's program and the whole ICME-14 Congress. Okay, this was a message from Professor Fan. And now, before the presentation, it's my pleasure to introduce our presenter, co-presenter, and workshop assistant briefly to you. Professor Marcelo Borba is a presenter of our workshop one. He is a professor of the graduate program in mathematics education and of the mathematics department at UNESP in Brazil, where he chairs a research group, GPIMEM. Marcelo researches the use of digital technology in mathematics education, online distance education, modeling as a pedagogical approach, and qualitative research methodology. He is an associate editor of ZDM Mathematics Education, the International Journal of Mathematics Education. Dr. Liliane is a co-presenter for our workshop. She is currently an assistant professor at the State University of Santa Cruz, working as a researcher also in the research group GPIMEM. She conducts research in the area of digital technologies and mathematics education, with emphasis on the use and production of video based on the studies of multimodality from the perspective of functional systematic analysis. And Juliana is a PhD student supervised by Professor Borba, works as assistant for our workshop. So now let's enter into the first part of the workshop one. Professor Borba, do you want to say hi to all the participants in our workshop?
Sure, Sophie. First of all, good morning, good afternoon, good night to, I guess it's good morning to the people who are there in the room with you. For me, it's good night. You can see now Juliana Stahl that was introduced already. Liliane is having a few problems with the internet, but she should be able to come at any time. So welcome to this workshop. I do hope that as you watch the videos, you just comes with lots of questions and issues, and we're gonna have an hour to deal with them. So I'm very honored that you chose this workshop. Greetings from Brazil. And so I guess this is it, Sophie.
Okay, thank you. And now we can look at the presentation on qualitative research methodology.
So, good morning, good afternoon, good night. For us in Brazil, we are recording at night and our session is gonna be at night. So this is our Congress. Let me introduce you I'm Marcelo Borba, and here is our contact. We thought about doing a workshop for early researcher with an experienced researcher, Marcelo Borba, from the graduate program of maths education, Liliane Neves, who just got her PhD 2 years ago, and Juliana, who is in the second year of her PhD. So we are all members of the GPIME, our research group. And look, São Paulo is based right here, you know, in this area. You can see here in the map of Brazil. And Juliana is from Paraná. I am from Rio de Janeiro. And Liliane is from Bahia in the Northeast. We all came to Rio Claro for different reasons, but all united for math education. Okay, so this is our workshop. I hope you enjoy it. And we're going to be talking about qualitative research and with focus on the research on video. And due to more difficulty with English, Liliane and Juliana are going to speak less than me, but we did the whole thing together. So welcome to our workshop. So what is qualitative research? What's research on videos? Okay, this is our main part now. Well, Creswell, an author from the US, I think he, you know, have a nice definition when they say that if we conduct a qualitative research because a problem or issue that needs to be explored, in turn, this exploration is necessary due to the need to us to study a group or a population, identify variables that cannot be easily measured or listened to. In other words, or to some silent voices. So this is very important. That's what qualitative research is about. If we think about qualitative research in a way, in this area of scientific development, we can talk about three big eras, and Lincoln and Gubin, this classic book that's more than 35 years old these days. It talks about pre-positivistic, positivist, and post-positivist. Be careful, because this word in particular has one too many meanings. But we can think of pre-positivists, of everything that came before what we call science, and the part that comes with names like Newton and all that. So the whole idea of what has been developing in ancient Greece has to do with this era. Is the main idea is that you observe, but you don't do anything with nature. Is the positivist era, the people who have very positive view of science, in which they do, well, we can do experiment, and we can experiment, and somehow these could be the base for our truth. There's quite a bit of, in this book, about five different kinds of truth. And it's a very interesting book. I think it's a book that I recommend for the density and clarity at the same time. Let me talk about some of the things which are more interesting, which they contrast with positivists and naturalists. What is this naturalist? It's because, as I told you, post-positivism, you may have many, many, many kinds of perspectives. And one of them is called naturalist because it has as a claim that you should try to develop research in a natural setting, in a place where things happen. So it could be a school, it could be sometimes, you know, another educational setting, since we're talking to math educators, but it could be now virtual settings as we are doing. And some authors like myself have developed this idea of virtual settings. So we can have this. We can have the idea of not having a law that's gonna be valid forever. We're not gonna have some laws like maybe some in physics, but we're gonna have some ideas that came from grassroots observation, from observation in locals. And some of them, you know, we're gonna come with different kind of theories in which cause and effect are combining. And there's no way to distinguish it because there are so many influences. And you're not going to be looking for cause and effects, but you're going to be looking for correlations. There are many other differences, but we should also be thinking about this one here because it's very important in the moment that we live, in the pandemic. So our kind of research, it's open for values. And I would say that we should all be really looking about values that we should input in our research in this moment where millions of people have died for this pandemic. Some of them, like the ones in my country, more people have died for completely incompetence of our president. And I know this reality is very different throughout the world. But we are developing research in math education and pandemic, and I'll talk a little bit about it in the end. Maybe if you ask some questions, I can do that later. But we're pretty much setting an agenda. But in any case, let's talk about what kind of implication we have for research when we be doing this kind of research in naturalistic paradigm. We have emergent design. That means that was very important for Juliana, for many of her colleagues who are doing the PhD. So we had prepared a whole research and the pandemic comes, we have to adapt that. And we have also, in this case, to be developing much more, but that has happened before the pandemic as well. But it's also very important for us to see and to admit that these kind of things can happen. In any case, I think that there are many other principles, and we can come back to them. But one of them is that when we find results of a research, we go and talk to the actors of that research. We tend not to tell them subjects, but participants. Because they also
excuse me, Marcelo.
Gave their open their lives for us when we go and we ask an interview, when we develop an interview to a specific group. So in this kind of research, the kind of a case study mode is very important, not only for research, but also for the type of text that we write. We might be coming to more particular, you know, and with a subjective approach and interpretation. We don't have laws, we have provisional applications. And then when one things change from one school to another, these results change. And many other principles, but that I would like to be showing for you in this area here. And I would say, that we believe that humans, and Marcelo, Liliane, and Juliana, are the main instrument. We're gonna be talking in this way, we're somehow telling humans are instrument, but we're humans as instrument. In other words, we're gonna tell instrument as humans, like coronas has influenced everybody, but pretty much we're talking about computers influencing others. So we do use tacit knowledge many times to interview someone. If we are now, like everybody in the pandemic is teaching you know, online somehow. It's learning online. And sometimes we have to be very flexible with what we see in other people's house. Here it's my dining room. Now it's a mix of dining room and library. And at the same time, this whole thing, like many people's life, which get mixed up work with our work with our personal life. So we have to use part of that. And we use qualitative methods, which is very important for us. So we're going to be using interviews. We're not going to be thinking about measuring things. We're going to be looking for comprehension. We're not going to get a kind of, let's get a sampler and a sample that somehow that can represent everybody. No, we're going to go to look for that case. So now we sometimes are going to be looking for seeing who are doing online mathematics education for kids, an area of research that had not been explored before the pandemic, and people had to jump into it without any research. And the little research from other areas many times were not even used. So we do inductive data analysis. What it means? What does this mean? It comes from the examples, and we keep going and building and going. And in order to try to not generalize, but somehow build examples that, with my experience in Brazil, you may use in the country where you are at. And we really search for grounded theory. In other words, we get theories, we study theories that already existed, but we try to somehow study the situation. We don't think, for instance, that there is any theory that could explain the situation that we are living in the pandemic. And there is not one situation. That's one example of multiple realities. It's very different from somebody who is from the middle class in Brazil and is living this with a nice house, even though my dining room is had become into an office. But there is other rooms, you know, for my older kids who are here doing home university at home and home office, one of them. So it's very important for us to have these principles over here. So this research methodology is related to the set of methods and or ways that are followed in somehow in the research process and its systematization. In other words, it involves the ways and options taken in the search for understanding and interpretation about the formulated question. The book is in Portuguese, but anyways, here's a picture for you. Just so it becomes, it's a mess here with coffee, water, and books, and different books in different language, mainly Portuguese, Spanish, and English. But in any case, it's very important that we come to this definition. As we make the option for qualitative research, it's like a package in which paradigm and the research questions and the kind of methods we use, we try to shape one another. So each one of them shape one another. So we're not focused exactly on test performance, and we're trying to see, well, how do people actually know, or how do they make mistakes, and how can that mistake show some good part of what they thought, or maybe the mistake shows that the problem we formulated was not correct. So part two is research on videos. I hope it's clear for you that qualitative research is a kind of research that does not focus on measure. If he somehow he used kind of a recording, many times using videos and many times using cell phones and all that for recording and for filming, but also we have research on videos. Vila Real and Borba, and I'll show you later then, or maybe here it is, we did, wrote this book on Springer. This one here is in English, you can see more, but this is another paper. This is a 2005 book, but you can do afterwards the Springer book that I'm sure you would enjoy, and there's also a whole chapter about research methodology. But here we talk a lot about, and in this book as well, how a media can condition the way we think. And I think everybody now agrees with that after the pandemic, with this year and a half or 2 years that everybody's been using a lot of technology. So our education has somehow changed. And we've been talking a whole lot also. We talk quite a bit, I wrote quite a bit with my colleagues such as Liliane and Juliana in terms about information technology and maths education in general. But of course, now we've been paying attention for quite a while about how technology is changing the way we do lit review, we do interview, data collection, in which we use quite a bit of videos. And also how internet, as I mentioned before, can be seen as a way, as means of people having a natural setting. Well, now we have this natural setting here. This video is being recorded by four people, besides the three of us that you already see. There's also Geraldo Lima, who you're gonna get to know at the end, have a face for, who is the technician, who is behind a lot of the action that's going on here. So, multimodality research and teaching of mathematics, it's how we're gonna be putting together this whole idea that multimodality is being intensified by digital technology. And we've been having more and more interactions with images, now with my body language, with my hand language, and everything else. Why videos in mathematics education? Well, digital mathematical performance is an alternative to transform the negative image of school mathematics and mathematicians, in addition to being a vehicle to bring the pleasure of mathematical activity to school contexts. Some of the papers we wrote with Brazilian colleagues and Canadian friends. The possibility of joining multiple resources for the construction of mathematical discourse in videos make this technology promise for the construction of mathematical knowledge, which is one of the main conclusions, and she had many examples. Unfortunately, in Portuguese, it's Liliane Neves who has this, but there's a chapter coming out in a Springer handbook about the way, in detail, part of what I'll be telling you here about how did Liliane led the research of this part of the video. Research on videos and mathematics education. Look, qualitative studies may use videos to record the interaction of students and teachers in order to analyze them further and understand different ways of mathematics may be produced by collective students, teacher, and media. That's one thing I already told you. So there are two things here. There's to use videos for research, but we're gonna be talking quite more about research with students and teachers who make their videos. And how can we understand the mathematics that they do there? Video mathematics classes, it's another use. So I'm sure everybody has lived some kind of experience as a student or as a teacher of having a video, for instance, to introduce some kind of content or to show some application of content and video productive activities. This is what we're starting to do and to really focus, you know? We ask students with our help to produce videos and try to identify what kind of mathematics they produce, what kind of things they are doing as they develop this video. Well, and in a paper that I wrote with Liliane Neves, we talk about all the steps, all the organization that students have to do that. They got to choose a mathematical content. They got to choose a way of applying it. We have to many times have some theoretical deepening of the chosen content. We have to go study math in textbooks, in videos, in video classes in the internet, preparation of the video scripts, research on the accessible ways to produce and edit the videos, production of the first version of the videos until the final production of this. Is Liliane still there with us? So we can be talking about the next part. Or Liliane, oh yes, Liliane is here. Liliane, as I told you, she finished her PhD 2 years ago. And now she's teaching intensively in Bahia, in North State. And she's our specialist in our group. So she left Rio Claro, but we always talking to her because we learn a lot with our grad students, with their early researchers. And I say, oh, not a problem that the English is not too good. We're going to have Liliane telling us some things that is very important from her research.
Thank you, Marcelo. Well, the systemic functional theory engages research in the field of linguistics who consider other resources beyond the language in the communication and production of meanings. There are some approaches based on systemic functional theory, which differ by their objectives. In our research, we have relied on socio-semiotics, which focuses on the social dimensions of meaning production and the systemic functional multimodal discourse analysis, which seeks to understand and describe the function of resources used to produce meaning, in addition to analyzing the meaning resulting from the semiotic choice for combining that resources.
So yes, and this is very nice, that's what she's talking about it.
The two resources represent that two approaches are Professor K. O'Halloran and Professor Gunther Kress.
As you can see, and you're going to have access to the PowerPoint, they have many books and they're the main source of inspiration for us.
According to the systemic functional multimodal discourse analysis, meaning in dynamic, that is, meaning are constructed and reconstructed depending on the situation and cultural context. Some important notions of systemic functional multimodal discourse analysis are semiotic resources refer to sets of resources shaped over time by socially and culturally organized communities to produce meaning. Intersemiosis, this is the process of combining semiotic resources for communication. Recontextualizing, it is the change of context or situation that can generate a change in meaning. And resemiotization is the change in meaning usually result from recontextualization. What we have been doing in our research is to use that notions in order to analyze the possibilities of producing meanings in videos with mathematical content. For example, we can understand recontextualization and resemiotization in deducing the equation of the circumference in analytical geometry. We initially have a geometry contest in which the circle is in the Cartesian plane with fixed entities referring to the center, radius, and any point on the circle. In intersemiosis, we combine fixed entities with geometry from the Pythagorean theory and obtain the equation of the circle, now with variable entities, in an algebraic context.
So Liliane has really studied, you know, the work of Cale Halloran and the work of our friends here too, which are very, you know, with many Brazilian followers here. We got Cress and O'Halloran, and she has taught me how multiple representations, which was the work that I did in my PhD with Jack Confrey, with Jim Caput, talking about these representations that Liliane just said, they were good, but they were not sufficient for a work with videos. Liliane analyzed many videos from undergraduate students in online courses in Brazil. That was her research and how she developed that as part of a major project of our research group. And she said, yes, Marcelo. And we talked quite a bit about multiple representation was not enough. We have to go under. If we did in 1993 talked that maybe a good definition for understanding in mathematics could be coordinating different representation. Now we come with this much more powerful ideas of multiplier meaning. And that's what Liliane shows in many videos, and we would like to be telling here that you can do, is how if you have one representation, it's not an addition to have another one. It's just something that expands, that dialectically explode. And we have many meanings, like many times if you see this picture of this worker is much more this picture and the text of what is saying here, especially for you who cannot read Portuguese. So, but then you are in a way of telling, what does image tell us? And that's, you know, here the translation of what's written here. And then you can just see how a video that if it's talking about mathematics and it has the image of this man, how can this be very much transformed? Functions of language and symbolism. So that's what I said. Here is where, you know, Marcelo was in this beginning. So we have verbal representation. We are doing, including some research about this and videos and going on. The algebraic representation is concise. Manipulating algebraic objects is sometimes the only method of justifying or proving general statements. Images are presented as resources that allow the visualization of the relationships established between mathematical entities and that make it possible to visualize the mathematical phenomenon as a whole in its parts. It has much more on a video. You know, you have body language. You have music, which we don't have it here. And please don't ask me to start singing, you not like it. But many people do sing much. And sometimes we have all this meaning being multiplied. And at the same time, we do have what? We have that explosion, and in 6 minutes, in 10 minutes, you can tell in a video and involve people with some ideas related to a mathematical concept that you cannot do in a regular lecture using, right, the blackboard and all the other tools that we are used to use. So this is sound effects, scenarios, camera movements that go and do it here. Now I'm just doing this here all the time because I have two monitors here for this talk. But look, the plans, the different plans, the image that we do, and we still have to create sounds for mathematics, right? We do have sounds when we watch a movie that we know that something dangerous is gonna happen because of the music. We gotta be constructing these sounds and things and emotions for mathematics as well. The logical and the aesthetic synthesis of videos is something that we're trying to investigate. But it seemed to us that people who watch a video and much more people who produce videos, they really go deep into a knowledge. They really are trying to put that together in things like how can we put a nice music for that? How can we make a joke here and then come back to the content? So this combination of different semiotic resources is one thing that Liliane and others from the team are doing. So the use of cinematographical resource to stand out with a speech that's different from the one we use in the classroom. And I would say, maybe this is the new classroom. This is the classroom that is somehow changing, that we're moving a little bit for that to happen. And that's what Liliane and I wrote in a paper. And here is Liliane to then also in that paper, we talked quite a bit about the different approach of semiotic functional theory. And once in a while, I couldn't go to a book, but I send a WhatsApp to Liliane and ask, so about this idea and whatever, what do you think? Say, yes, yeah, this is a good idea. Oh, this one people never use, but maybe you can use and try to do that. And we've been changing and transforming theories. And recently in a thesis, in a dissertation that's gonna come out in July, we are putting together two of the frameworks that we're gonna talk about. But in any case, we are exploring this idea of intersemiosis performed in the videos with mathematical content. That's the papers that we've been developing together. And I really like that Liliane accepted the invitation to join us because it'd be very nice to have a recent graduate student being also working with us here. So we have to identify the video's context. Well, where in the video there is recontextualization and resemiotization? Where do we have identification of intersemiosis? Did that had a multiplier effect? If yes, how? Intersemiotic analysis and within, you know, one area, well, what are the things happening there? And the conjectures around the semantic expansions, were we able to give meaning in a more structured way? So this is what the research of Liliane and our interaction with Kay O'Halloran, with whom we have an international project, is being taking us to understanding a little bit more of videos in mathematics education. But Liliane is gonna tell you some more about this example. And you can look at the video here. The video is here. We're not gonna be able to have a chance to show you, but please take a look at during break, if you can, and take a look at this video. But please, Liliane, tell us more about it.
The civil construction video was produced by participants of research. This video presents mathematical content about the distance between points. In the analysis of this video, we identify resources such as verbal language, mathematical symbolism, and different types of images were combined in such a way that the inherent information to each one together produced a broader meaning around the mathematical concept in question. The deictic gestures were used intensively to associate the calculation developed from the mathematical symbolism, used the concept of vectors with the image that represented the house with the triangular roof.
So from this image, we have vertices, angles, and whatever, and many other things that we cannot see when we go from the video to the PowerPoint presentation. But this is the chapter with myself, Kay O'Halloran, and Liliane Neves that we're going to be present soon. Okay, things are getting late with the pandemic. And I'd like to thank very much Liliane for this, but she's still be back, you know, so don't say goodbye to her. Just see you later. But we do have to talk about the part four of this presentation. There's just two more. And I would like to now invite Juliana for this here. And we're going to start, you know, with showing you this video, which is a video about math news. The video is in Portuguese, but it has subtitles in English. So please press the subtitles option there, and we revised with a native speaker for the subtitles of that, okay? So thank you very much and enjoy the video, but we'll be back shortly.
Math News apresenta... Função exponencial e coronavírus.
Vou olhar um pouquinho as notícias no computador. Tendência da curva exponencial é só aumentar. Ai, ai. Eu nem lembro o que é uma curva exponencial. Mas essa reportagem aqui é interessante.
Meu Deus, quem será uma hora dessa?
Amiga?
Alô? Oi, amiga. Tudo bem?
Tudo mais ou menos, né? Com essa situação do coronavírus, as coisas estão bem complicadas.
Não, pois é, minha filha, nem me fala. Poxa, isso tá demais, né, amiga?
Ainda bem que eu tô fazendo isolamento social, assim como você, né? Porque a gente, além de se cuidar pela gente, tem que se cuidar pelos outros também.
Menina, que loucura é essa, gente? Olha, eu não tô dando conta. Aqui em casa tá uma loucura, você precisa de ver. Você sabe, né, filha? Eu tenho dois filhos, né? A bebezinha e o outro mais velho. Esse mais velho tá fazendo aula remota e eu não tô dando conta de estar explicando pra ele esses exercícios que estão sendo passados.
Então, eu te liguei porque vai ter uma reportagem daqui a pouquinho falando sobre a situação do coronavírus na nossa cidade.
Tá terrível. Olha, minha vida tá uma loucura. Eu não tô tendo tempo nem de ver a televisão pra ver como é que tá essa situação. Só sei que meu esposo tá em casa, ele tá de quarentena, pegou esse vírus maldito. Você precisa de ver. Olha, tá uma loucura a minha vida. Eu não sei mais o que que eu faço. É muita correria. E a neném chorando o tempo todo. Nossa.
Tô tentando assistir rapidinho, vai ser daqui a pouco.
Pois é, né, amiga? Eu vou dar um jeitinho de assistir, assim, essa reportagem.
E tão falando que vou explicar direitinho sobre a curva exponencial. Porque eu lembro de ter estudado isso em algum momento, mas eu não lembro direito o que é. Mas eles vão explicar, e é bom a gente assistir, até pra gente poder explicar pras pessoas melhor a importância delas ficarem em casa.
Tá bom, eu vou dar uma olhadinha assim, tá?
Tá bom?
Tá joia, amiga. Beijo, tá? Fica com Deus.
Beijo, se cuida.
Boa noite, eu sou Maria Laura Mouzinho Leite Lopes, e hoje nós vamos tratar sobre função exponencial e coronavírus. Muito tem se falado sobre o achatamento da curva da função exponencial e coronavírus, mas você sabe o que é isso? Pois bem, vou te explicar.
A função exponencial é determinada pela lei de formação f de x é igual a elevado a x, onde a é uma constante positiva e diferente de 1, e x é a variável real. Ela é um tipo de função que cresce ou decresce muito rápido. Nesse caso, ela cresce rapidamente, porque a base é maior que 1, tornando-se assim uma função que não para de crescer positivamente, ou seja, uma função ilimitada superiormente. Calma, vamos te explicar de uma maneira mais simples. Uma pessoa consegue contaminar 2 pessoas em um primeiro contato, e cada uma dessas pessoas contaminam mais 2, tornando-se 4, que contaminam cada uma mais 2, tornando-se 8, e dobrando o número de infectados a cada novo contato. E assim, tanto o vírus quanto a notícia falsa vai alcançando um número imenso de pessoas. Isso faz com que, no caso específico do coronavírus, o sistema de saúde entre em colapso por não ter como atender a todos de uma vez. Uma vez atingido certo ponto da curva, torna-se impossível controlar a disseminação, tanto do vírus quanto das notícias falsas, já que o crescimento é tão rápido que as medidas de prevenção não são suficientes para conter o crescimento de ambos. Por isso, assim como checar as notícias antes de repassá-las, o isolamento social e as medidas de prevenção são os recursos mais eficazes para conter o contínuo crescimento exponencial, ou seja, achatar a tal curva de contágio.
Agora que esclarecemos um pouco sobre esse tipo de função e a importância do achatamento da curva, vamos para mais informações sobre o município de hoje, Duque de Caxias.
Para isso, nós vamos chamar o nosso repórter Leibniz. E aí, Leibniz?
Como está Duque de Caxias?
Boa noite. Não trago boas notícias. Até hoje, dia 27 de abril de 2020, já foram registrados 67 mortes por coronavírus aqui em Duque de Caxias. O município atualmente conta com maior taxa de mortes da Baixada Fluminense e é o segundo maior no número total de casos em todo o estado. São 319 doentes confirmados até o momento. Mesmo assim, diariamente são registrados flagrantes de desrespeito ao isolamento social. Para quem visita a cidade, parece que não há pandemia. Lojas abertas, pessoas na rua sem máscara e aglomeradas. Se tudo continuar assim, dificilmente essa curva será achatada. É com você, Maria Laura.
Obrigada pelas informações, Leibniz.
Fica aqui o nosso pedido. Se possível, fique em casa. Siga todas as orientações de proteção e de isolamento social para que juntos a gente possa achatar essa curva que, infelizmente, cresce com alta taxa de variação. Não só em Duque de Caxias, mas em todo o nosso Brasil. Boa noite.
So, Marcelo, what did you think about the video MEF News?
Oh, hi, Juliana. Thank you so much for your question. It's one of the videos I like the best. And do you know why is that? Because those are people who came back to school to have their second chance of education. They could not have regular education, you know, at the right age, let's put it this way. And they do a fantastic video talking about exponential function, talking about the pandemic with 3 months of the pandemic, you know, 4 months of the pandemic, they were making videos and making videos from their home. And once we interviewed them afterwards, after the, you know, the festival has ended, you know that they have very little conditions. If you had noticed, the woman who is holding a baby and is using the cell phone, it's not a cell phone, you know, it's the remote control of their TV because the cell phone was being used to film. So he has to do things. So they improvised and they did very important video on exponential functions, putting together the two main news of Brazil and the US at least, fake news and the COVID crisis. So that's very nice. But I think now you should tell us more about the festival so that people can understand more about the festivals.
Yes, thank you, Marcelo. So, the video presented are produced by students and teachers, are part of the 4th Digital Videos Festival in Mathematics Education as an extension activity contributing to the collection of mathematical videos. Currently, they are the object of study of one of the researchers that are being developed by one of the members of GPM. What is the Digital Videos Festival in Mathematics Education? So, this festival has the objective is to generate the culture of videos production and analysis, being a virtual interlocutor, a space for dissemination and mathematical discussion. Another objective is investigation of the videos production process inside and or outside classroom. The first editions occurred in 2017. We are currently working in the 50th edition. So, this festival has 5 categories for the people send the video with mathematics content, such are final years of elementary school, high school, university education, professors in action, and general community, are articulated with the aforementioned festival. There is a project new in 2021. The name of the project is Digital Videos Festivals and Mathematics Education in Classroom in Motion between face, the face-to-face, and the virtual. Activity theory and social semiotics will be the central theoric framework for analyzing the data, production of research in action with the technology perspective that understand that the human beings and digital technologies should not be viewed in a dichotomous way. Now I show you some researchers that are articulated with the project and the festival. The first one is Domingues 2020 and Domingues and Borba 2021 used activity theory to understand the process of creating a video. The research in question is, what is the relationship between mathematics videos, videos festival, and the new 21st century mathematics classroom? About the framework, we have an example of animation that was created for Marcelo and me, based on Sanino and Engelstrom 2018, and have some elements, instrument, subject, rules, community, division of labor, and object. About the animation, the internet is in motion, yeah? Is in movement, change of the place, it depends of the event. Some moment is instrument, another subject, and another community. About the research on digital videos, have researcher methods and are interviews with video producers, triangulation with analysis of video submitted to the festival, focus group with participants in the festival final. And another research is my research. I started in 2020. My supervisor is Marcelo Borba. And the researcher question is, which mathematics present in the videos is produced by collective humans with media? So, Marcelo, please.
Yes, and before I go to the last part, I would like to make some comments about this part here. Juliana presented to us two very important parts and very nice parts, which is like activity theory and social semiotics. We've been using that to put together the history of the videos, how the videos are made, and at the same time to look closer and see how the videos can be interpreted. So let's say that Liliane, who presented first, is the one who somehow look at the videos like this. And the example that Juliana presented by Newton Dominguez is the one who you can see with activity theory, how the object of the group of students to make a video change over the years, how over the years, over the months, and how is that, what is the process for that to develop the video? In what context was that? Was that pressure from school for them to participate in the festival? Was that an option? In the case of the in-service students, was that future teachers? What do they want to do with that? So there's a lot of research coming out with that. And I would like to tell you that research methodology, we can see a lot, as I put in this book here, as the interface of methods and a view of knowledge. And I would say that now, more and more, with a view of world. So we cannot anymore, with the pandemic, think that our research is somehow neutral. We have to be thinking that things were changing very fast in maths education, but now even more. We do have, you know, the whole idea of a set of papers now that you can hear by some Johan Engelbrecht from South Africa, Salvador Linhares from Spain, and myself. We've been collaborating a lot doing research on digital technology, but we have to interrupt our paper because the pandemic has arrived and we have to be telling about this. And we thought would be COVID-19, but we already wrote in that paper that maybe was COVID-20, and it's already 2021. And we hope stops here, but we don't know. And how are we gonna be talking and understanding this? What is the relation of videos and the culture of the 21st century? But what is the relationship of research and maths education and the pandemic now? In this paper recently published, you know, the one by Engelbrecht was in the published at CDM, and we had a nice editorial written with Gabrielle Kaiser. But this paper by myself, we gave another understanding about the idea that digital technology do have important effect in education. Now it seems easy to say that, like Bruno Latour and others have been telling, the virus do have some effect. They do have some agents. And more than that, homes have agency. We do have more and more the ones who have nice houses that it can distribute people to have education, and the ones who had online education, emergence online education, in a ways with six people and one mobile and one computer, if they're lucky, for six people in the family. This brought us back to this whole idea of bringing critical mathematics education to the center. We cannot think that we're going to have good mathematics education with everybody, you know, having such a social inequality. And social inequality has grown quite a bit in Brazil and elsewhere. And the richest in the world get richer, and the poor get even more poor. There is not much research on online mathematics education for young children. But if the crisis lasts for a long time, are we going to implement without sufficient research? Is the current crisis ever sooner, or are we going to develop research on mathematics education for a possible COVID-2X crisis? Or it could be 3X, we don't know. So these are the kind of things we are asking this paper with, led by my colleague, Johanna Engelbrecht, and which was published on ZDM. I believe they are available for free. In any case, in Borba 2021 and in 2020, I think it's very important for you, early researcher, and who are finishing your PhD, we have to be thinking critically too about digital technology. Was our movement that made this virus grow and become into a pandemic so fast? Conversely, if the crisis lasts for a long period, as we know now, the only solution has to be together with digital technology. So videos are part of it. Videos may help to show different aspects of social reality, like the videos might have seen. And we would like to finish, or almost finish, because I'll come back to tell your last word with you watching another video of another crisis. This one was not pandemic, but was very important in Brazil. And those are 12, 13 years old, doing very good mathematics at their level. Look at this video.
Em 57 hectares,
não são apenas números sem contexto. Você sabe quanto vale isso?
Isso valeu muitas vidas.
Muita destruição.
E muitas histórias.
Foi uma tragédia!
Somos mineiros, das Minas Gerais, e não podemos nos calar diante de tanta tragédia.
Diante do histórico de rupturas de barragem de mineradoras, levamos o tema para as aulas de matemática. Conversamos, pesquisamos e chegamos à conclusão que gostaríamos de saber como seria possível recuperar um meio ambiente devastado por aquele terrível mar de lamas. Ao final de toda a conversa, decidimos que o nosso objetivo era responder quanto de rejeito proveniente da ruptura de barragem do córrego do Feijão na cidade de Brumadinho deverá ser retirado para iniciar um projeto de recuperação ambiental. Para escolher a área a ser estudada, procuramos imagens de satélite. Nem todas registravam a tragédia. Escolhemos a imagem que mostrava a lama e tomamos o trecho mais próximo à barragem. Decidimos construir uma maquete para melhor modelar o relevo.
Para isso, precisamos de mapas topográficos. Utilizamos curvas de níveis com espaçamento de 10 em 10 metros. Recortamos o molde em papel e depois transferimos para o isopor. Como cada placa de isopor tem meio centímetro e cada placa representa uma cota da curva de nível, então a escala de trabalho foi que cada 1 centímetro na maquete correspondia a 20 metros na realidade.
Por meio de um programa online de imagens de satélites, verificamos que a lama atingiu a cota 790. Construímos duas maquetes, uma com foco na altimetria e a outra no relevo e vegetação. Nesta, fizemos a simulação da tragédia da lama.
Com o mapa topográfico, conseguimos fazer o molde da cota 790, ou seja, ao calcular essa área, estávamos determinando uma parte da área devastada.
E agora? Temos o molde da área, mas só sabemos calcular a área de quadrados. Como calcular essa área esquisita?
A professora disse que era para a gente escolher um tamanho de quadrado que cada grupo quisesse. Então começamos a preencher o molde da lama. Quando não coubesse mais, era para fazer outros quadrados, com a medida do lado sendo metade da medida do lado do quadrado anterior. e quando não coubesse mais, era novamente para fazer novos quadrados, com o lado medindo metade da medida do lado do quadrado anterior.
E assim, cada grupo escolheu a medida inicial e foi fazendo quadrados, cada vez menores, até preenchermos toda a área do molde. Fizemos uma tabela para ajudar a calcular a área total. Depois de preenchida a tabela, chegamos à conclusão de que a área que estamos estudando tem 570 mil metros quadrados. Aprendemos que existe uma unidade de medida chamada hectare. Cada hectare corresponde a 10 mil metros quadrados. Então, o nosso trabalho estava sendo realizado em cima de uma área de aproximadamente 57 hectares.
E aí, gente? Ainda não temos nossa questão respondida. Precisamos calcular o tanto de lama que a gente tem que tirar de lá.
Aprendemos que calcular a quantidade de lama é o mesmo que calcular o seu volume.
Mas como fazer isso? Nós supomos que um sólido formado pela lama fosse igual a uma placa de isopor na maquete. A gente calculou a área da base e multiplicou pela altura desejada.
Isso foi uma matéria que não tem no nosso livro. Tinha umas continhas com letra, tipo base vezes altura. Nós aprendemos a calcular áreas de retângulo, triângulos e trapézios. Subdividimos a região desejada em polígonos, que a gente sabia calcular a sua área.
Nessa região verde mais escura, passa um rio. Aqui é a cota 770. A área dessa cota deu 94.760 metros quadrados. Calculamos o volume considerando uma altura de 11 metros, sendo 1 metro de profundidade do rio e 10 metros até a próxima cota.
Nesse próximo tom de verde é a cota 780. Essa área deu 428.672 metros quadrados. Para calcular o seu volume, pegamos o valor da área e multiplicamos por 10 metros de altura, quando chega na cota 790, que é o nível que a lama atingiu nessa região.
Após calcularmos as áreas das cotas 770 e 780, estimamos o volume total, que deu aproximadamente 5.330.000 metros cúbicos.
Com os dados do nosso trabalho, esperamos ajudar os moradores de Brumadinho. Mas como?
Reivindicar das autoridades estratégias para uma recuperação ambiental.
Para ter uma recuperação ambiental, precisamos de retirar a lama de lá. Por exemplo, colocar ela numa pilha de rejeito.
Para estimar o custo para retirar essa lama, fizemos assim. Supomos que conseguimos um local para armazenar a pilha de rejeito, situada aproximadamente a 10 km de distância. Orçamos uma empresa de transporte e ela cobra R$ 3,00 por tonelada por quilômetro percorrido pelo caminhão. Os caminhões utilizados transportam 30 toneladas.
Esse valor chegou a quase R$ 1 bilhão de reais.
Será que as autoridades vão fazer isso?
Mar de lama!
Well, I hope you have enjoyed this video, and we have here all the references that we use. I invite Liliane and Juliana back, and also Geraldo Lima, our technician, who is now here with us. But before we say thank you, I would like to tell you a few more words. Look at this, my friends. We have here a collective of humans with internet, with a software, doing this presentation for an online presentation. We try to present the principles of qualitative research, and we show two wonderful examples with Liliane, who led a research in our group and still leads, even though have finished here having other jobs, about how she did videos and analyzed videos and develop a way of understanding this. Juliana is now starting her research with philosophical underpinnings and trying to understand how the view of mathematics, in which philosophy of mathematics to students and teachers deal with that. So I hope you have enjoyed our video that in order to know about qualitative research, I presented two examples because we're looking at videos. We're not interested in measuring. We're not telling that who uses videos is better than others and that you should not use other things. No, you should keep using Blackboard. You should keep using many other things. But please, you know, open your mind to you for this transformation. This mobile has changed our lives. The synthesis of computers and whatever had reorganized our thinking and have changed the way we do research as well. And we should be thinking about theoretical frameworks such as social semiotics, such as the one with humans with media, to develop research about technology with this. Never forgetting that social semiotics, by Kramer, by Cale Halloran, they take into consideration the context that the notion of humans with media and the philosophies of mathematics and humanistic mathematics take into aspect the social issues. And what social are we talking about? Social that make the difference. Social that maybe we can overcome social inequality in this world with research in mathematics education. It's a little part of it. And I don't think that research on mathematics education can transform the world. But without research in mathematics education, kids are gonna keep suffering, and the math classroom without digital technology and without videos is gonna be very far away of everybody's experience. Thank you so much. I'm really looking forward for your questions, criticisms, and whatever you have. Hello, Liliane, thank you so much. And Juliana, who should all say goodbye. Thank you, Geraldo Lima, for all this and for the nice editing that you just started doing and you're gonna do later. Stay safe, and I'll see you in a minute for questions.
So thank you, Professor Borba, Dr. Lilian, and Juliana for preparing such a wonderful and a meaningful presentation for research on videos. So I have to apologize that at the beginning, the audio is too low to follow. So we will replay the first part of the presentation, like about 15 minutes. And before that, so our online and also on-site audience may have some questions and want to have further discussions with our presenters. So you may write down your questions, and we will have like a 30 minutes coffee and tea break. So we will replay the first part of the video like from 9:45 to 10 o'clock. And then we will have a coffee and tea break from 10 to 10:30. And then we will go to the second interactive part. We are sorry for the inconvenience it caused. Thank you.
In this area, so welcome to our, well, Cresswell, an author from the US. I think he, you know, have a nice definition when they say that if we conduct a qualitative research because a problem or issue that needs to be explored, in turn, this exploration is necessary due to the need to us to study a group or a population. Identify variables that cannot be easily measured or listened to, in other words, or to some silent voices. So this is very important. That's what qualitative research is about. If we think about qualitative research in a way, in this area of scientific development, we can talk about three big eras, and Lincoln and Gubin, this classic book that's more than 35 years old these days. It talks about pre-positivistic, positivist, and post-positivist. Be careful, because this word in particular has one too many meanings. But we can think of pre-positivists, of everything that came before what we call science, and the part that comes with names like Newton and all that. So the whole idea of what has been developing ancient Greece has to do with this era. Is the main idea is that you observe, but you don't do anything with nature. Is the positivist era, the people who have a very positive view of science, in which they do, well, we can do experiment, and we can experiment, and somehow this could be the base for our truth. There's quite a bit of, in this book, about five different kinds of truth. And it's a very interesting book. I think it's a book that I recommend for the density and clarity at the same time. Let me talk about some of the things which are more interesting, which they contrast with positivist and naturalist. What is this naturalist? It's because, as I told you, post-positivism, you may have many, many, many kinds of perspectives. And one of them is called naturalist, because it has as a claim that you should try to develop research in a natural setting, in a place where things happen. So it could be a school, it could be sometimes, you know, another educational setting, since we're talking to math educators, but it could be now virtual settings, as we are doing. And some authors like myself have developed this idea of virtual settings. So we can have this, we can have the idea of not having a law that's gonna be valid forever. We're not gonna have some laws like maybe some in physics, but we're gonna have some ideas that came from grassroots observation, from observation in locus. And some of them, you know, we're gonna come with different kind of theories in which cause and effect are combining. And there's no way to distinct it, because there are so many influences, and you're not gonna be looking for cause and effects, but you're gonna be looking for correlations. There are many other differences, but we should also be thinking about this one here, because it's very important in the moment that we live, in the pandemic. So our kind of research, it's open for values. And I would say that we should all be really looking about values that we should input in our research in this moment where millions of people have died for this pandemic. Some of them, like the ones in my country, more people have died for completely incompetence of our president. And I know this reality is very different throughout the world. But we are developing research in math education and pandemic, and I'll talk a little bit about it in the end. Maybe if you ask some questions, I can do that later. But we're pretty much setting an agenda. But in any case, let's talk about what kind of implication we have for research when we be doing this kind of research in a naturalistic paradigm. We have emergent design. That means that was very important for Juliana, for many of her colleagues who were doing the PhD. So we had prepared a whole research, and the pandemic comes, we have to adapt that. And we have also, in this case, to be developing much more. But that has happened before the pandemic as well. But it's also very important for us to see and to admit that these kind of things can happen. In any case, I think that there are many other principles, and we can come back to them. But one of them is that when we find results of a research, we go and talk to the actors of that research. We tend not to tell them subjects, but participants, because they also, they gave their, open their lives for us when we go and we ask an interview, when we develop an interview to a specific group. So in this kind of research, the kind of a case study mode is very important, not only for research, but also for the type of text that we write. We might be coming to more particular, you know, and with a subjective approach and interpretation. We don't have laws, we have provisional applications. And then when one things change from one school to another, these results change. And many other principles, but that I would like to be showing for you in this area here. And I would say that we believe that humans, and Marcelo, Liliane, and Juliana, are the main instrument. We're gonna be talking in this way, we're somehow telling humans are instrument, but we're humans as instrument. In other words, we gotta tell instrument as humans, like coronas has influenced everybody, but pretty much we're talking about computers influencing others. So we do use tacit knowledge many times to interview someone. If we are now, like everybody in the pandemic is teaching, you know, online somehow, is learning online. And sometimes we have to be very flexible with what we see in other people's house. Here it's my dining room. Now it's a mix of dining room and library. And at the same time, this whole thing, like many people's life, which get mixed up work with our work with our personal life. So we have to use part of that. And we use qualitative methods, which is very important for us. So we're gonna be using interviews. We're not gonna be thinking about measuring things. We're gonna be looking for comprehension. We're not gonna get a kind of let's get a sampler and a sample that somehow that can represent everybody. No, we're gonna go to look for that case. So now we're sometimes are gonna be looking for seeing who are doing online mathematics education for kids, an area of research that had not been explored before the pandemic. And people had to jump into it without any research. And the little research from other areas many times were not even used. So we do inductive data analysis. What it means? What does this mean? It comes from the examples, and we keep going and building and going. And in order to try to not generalize, but somehow build examples that with my experience in Brazil, you may use in the country where you are at. And we really search for grounded theory. In other words, we get theories, we study theories that already existed, but we try to somehow study the situation. We don't think, for instance, that there is any theory that could explain the situation that we are living in the pandemic. And there is not one situation, that's one example of multiple realities. It's very different from somebody who is from the middle class in Brazil and is living this with a nice house, even though my dining room is had come into an office, but there is other rooms, you know, for my older kids who are here doing home university at home and home office, one of them. So it's very important for us to have these principles over here. So This research methodology is related to the set of methods and or ways that are followed in somehow in the research process and its systematization. In other words, it involves the ways and options taken in the search for understanding and interpretation about the formulated question. The book is in Portuguese, but anyways, here's a picture for you, just so you become, it's a mess here with coffee, water, and books, and different books in different language, mainly Portuguese, Spanish, and English. But in any case, it's very important that we come to this definition. As we make the option for qualitative research, it's like a package in which paradigm and the research questions and the kind of methods we use, we try to shape one another. So each one of them shape one another. So we not focus exactly on test performance, and we're trying to see, well, how do people actually know, or how do they make mistakes, and how can that mistake show some good part of what they thought, or maybe the mistake shows that the problem we formulated was not correct. So, part two is research on videos. I hope it's clear for you that qualitative research is a kind of research that does not focus on measure. If he somehow used kind of a recording, many times using videos and many times using cell phones and all that for recording and for filming, but also we have research on videos. Villarreal and Borba, and I'll show you later then, or maybe here it is, we did, wrote this book on Springer. This one here is in English, you can see more, but this is another paper. This is a 2005 book, but you can do afterwards the Springer book that I'm sure you would enjoy, and there's also a whole chapter about research methodology. But here we talk a lot about, and in this book as well, how a media can condition the way we think. And I think everybody now agrees with that after the pandemic, with this year and a half or 2 years that everybody's been using a lot of technology. So our education has somehow changed. And we've been talking a whole lot also. We talk quite a bit, I wrote quite a bit with my colleagues such as Liliane and Juliana in terms about information technology and maths education in general. But of course, now we've been paying attention for quite a while about how technology is changing the way we do lit review, we do interview, data collection, in which we use quite a bit of videos. And also how internet, as I mentioned before, can be seen as a way, as means of people having a natural setting. Well, now we have this natural setting here. This video is being recorded by four people, besides the three of us that you already seen. There is also Geraldo Lima, who you're gonna get to know at the end, have a face for, who is the technician, who is behind a lot of the action that's going on here. So, multimodality research and teaching of mathematics, it's how we're going to be putting together this whole idea that multimodality is being intensified by digital technology. And we've been having more and more interactions with images, now with my body language, with my hand language, and everything else. Why videos in mathematics education? Well, digital mathematical performance is an alternative to transform the negative image of school mathematics and mathematicians, in addition to being a vehicle to bring the pleasure of mathematical activity to school contexts. Some of the papers we wrote with Brazilian colleagues and Canadian friends. the possibility of joining multiple resources for the construction of mathematical discourse in videos make this technology promise for the construction of mathematical knowledge, which is one of the main conclusions, and she had many examples. Unfortunately, in Portuguese, it's Liliane Neves who has this, but there's a chapter coming out in a Springer handbook about the way, in detail, part of what I'll be telling you here about how did Liliane led the research of this part of the video. Research on videos and mathematics education. Look, qualitative studies may use videos to record the interaction of students and teachers in order to analyze them further and understand different ways of mathematics may be produced by collective students, teacher, and media. That's one thing I already told you. So there are two things here. There's to use videos for research, but we're going to be talking quite more about research with students and teachers who make their videos. And how can we understand the mathematics that they do there? Video mathematics classes, it's another use. So I'm sure everybody has lived some kind of experience as a student or as a teacher of having a video, for instance, to introduce some kind of content or to show some application of content and video productive activities. This is what we're starting to do and to really focus, you know? We ask students with our help to produce videos and try to identify what kind of mathematics they produce, what kind of things they are doing as they develop this video. Well, and in a paper that I wrote with Liliane Neves, we talk about all the steps, all the organization that students have to do that. They gotta choose a mathematical content. They gotta choose a way of applying it. We have to many times have some theoretical deepening of the chosen content. We have to go study math in textbooks, in videos, in video classes in the internet, preparation of the video scripts, research on the accessible ways to produce and edit the videos, production of the first version of the videos until the final production of this. Is Liliane still there with us? So we can be talking about the next part. Or Liliane, oh yes, Liliane is here. Liliane, as I told you, she finished her PhD 2 years ago. And now she's teaching intensively in Bahia, in North State. And she's our specialist in our group. So she left Rio Claro, but we always talking to her because we learn a lot with our grad students, with their early researchers. And I say, oh, not a problem that the English is not too good. We're gonna have Liliane telling us some things that is very important from her research.
Thank you, Marcelo. Well, the systemic functional theory engages research in the field of linguistics, who consider other resources beyond language in the communication and production of meanings. There are some approaches based on systemic functional theory, which differ by their objectives. In our research, we have relied on socio-semiotics, which focuses on the social dimensions of meaning production, and the systemic functional multimodal discourse analysis, which seeks
Hello, let's take a break and we'll start the interactive session at 10:30, like in 25 minutes. Thank you. Hello, everyone. So welcome back to our second session for interactive session. So as you can see, Professor Borba is already here. And thank you so much for being here. And I will briefly introduce the procedures of participation. So for our online audience, if you want to ask a question, please click on the reaction button at the bottom of the screen, and then click the raise your hands button, and I will unmute you, and it's your turn to speak. And also we have our on-site audience, and you can raise your hands physically, and our assistant will come to you. So I will take the questions one by one. Actually, I have a question. Can I take the opportunity to pose the first question? Okay, so regarding like the mass news in the festival created by students or teachers, so I just wondering like what kind of like motives that these students and teachers have like to create or make videos like that? And will the students or teachers receive any incentives or honors or like money or something else like to create like such videos? And I just wondering like if this festival is only for research purpose or it's like a separate project or things like that. Yeah, and that's my first question.
Thank you, Sophie. Thank you all for attending here. And maybe I'm going to speak more now because of English, but Liliane and Juliana, we're together here in a WhatsApp group, so we are exchanging things. But maybe Juliana wants to say some words. Whenever you do, you just raise your hand. If not, I'll just... keep going. Sophie, the dissertation that actually Juliana pointed out by Newton Dominguez, it actually is, it's on the motives that participants of the festival have. So we create the festival, and I'm going to ask Juliana to put the link here on the chat. For those of you who want to access, of course, it's in Portuguese, most videos, not with subtitles. But we created this to create a culture and also to develop research. But we do know that some of the participants, they have motives like they want to become a YouTuber, a famous mathematics YouTuber. Another ones, they are part of their work in at the university. Other ones were like evaluation. Their teachers put like 10% of the grade on making the video. And some others would like to be interacting with friends who are far away. So this is from the research of Dominguez, in which the videos were analyzed, but the main research procedure was one developed by interviews. We did interviews at the final section of the festival and also online interviews. So one research methodology for one purpose. And we do have Liliane Neves, who is here, the other research in which the focus were the video, much less interviews and much more the videos. And so she analyzed the videos using social semiotics. And I see here on the chat, there are people who are developing research on videos, and I already tell this person, which I could not get the name here, but I'll get the name. She sent just to me, I guess, not to everyone. But in any case, all of you who wants to get in touch with me, if you want to know more about papers and all that, just send me an email, okay? And I just put my email here again, but I have sent the PowerPoint, but it's also would be a pleasure to help people like Ho Chi Lin. I hope I have spoke reasonably. Yes, so Ho Chi Lin, who is
That's
doing
right.
Okay, thank you. Who is doing research with videos on Ohio State University. All right, okay, congratulations. So, Sophie, thank you for the organization, and thank you once more for this nice question too. I hope I have answered. If not, ask again, and I'll keep trying.
Thank you, you have already solved my questions. So, any other questions, like online or on-site?
So, people do not get, Sophie, prizes in money or anything because we did not get finance for that. But people do get acknowledgement. So, in this fifth festival now, there are, you know, one video, there is 2,500 likes. So they're talking to many people about their videos. And so they're creating a culture of people watching some videos that have to do with mathematics, videos like the ones we showed you during the presentation. Other questions, comments?
So like students like will be more motivated if they saw a lot of likes on their videos, and they may like improve or get a sense of accomplishment when they see these likes?
I think so. And we do have a video of a student who had special need, and he was in a regular school. And then he only became accepted once he had his video recognized into the school. And then the let's call the so-called normal kids would say, he's really good in making videos, you know, and was something that he was slow in many of the subjects and all that, but he was very good in making videos. So it does give some kind of possibilities. And for you who are on the site or here, you can also ask your question in Mandarin. And then Sophie can translate it to me, if that will make you more comfortable.
Yeah, I can do the translation here. So everyone here can post your questions in Mandarin, and I can do the translations for you.
You might want to say that to them in Mandarin,
okay.
Too.
Yeah. 大家可以问中文的问题，然后我这边都可以翻译，对。
Thank you. I understood that part.
I hope I was like a good translator, probably.
No, well, if not, you can be a good creator. So from what somebody says, you create another good question.
So Lin posed a question probably in a minute.
Is there a new question here? And I got a question. Okay.
Okay, I can unmute you and you can talk. It,
whatever
directly.
Is easier for you, Hu Qilin.
Oh, yeah, sure. So. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you, Professor Borba and Professor Lee. So I have a question is that, so from my pilot work to have students produce their videos, I found out that some students, they feel shy to watch the video they play. I mean, I'm sorry, they feel shy to watch their video, play for the public. So Yeah, especially like in your experience, like how do you deal with this situation? Like, because in the festival, I can imagine that many students, you know, some students, they did a great job, or their video was cool and fantastic, but some maybe not, it's just okay. And so how do you deal with this situation? Thank you.
Thank you, Ho Chi Minh, for your question. We have not done research on that, and that could be interesting. But what we know is that when the teachers make mandatory for them to make a video, most teachers will give them the option to make it public or to make it, you know, in a way that just the teacher can assess. There are many people who do not like to show their own face, so they don't show it. They just get image from the garden, from whatever, and make a mathematical problem. But there are others who like to show their family, and they are really happy. So they just go and they just go and show them into the, they like to show their background. So that's another thing, is that somehow, if Liliane were a student, she would show the beaches from Bahia, and then Juliana would show the mountains from Paraná, and, you know, Marcelo would show part of the landscape of São Paulo or Rio, where I'm from. So this could be different possibilities, okay, of how to deal with that. But I agree, we should be doing research on emotional issues about showing yourself quite in public on the internet. And there are many people who love it and other people who don't. You're very right on that. So, did I answer your question, Ho Chi Minh? Yes.
Yes, yes, thank you.
Can you tell me a little bit about what is your research, since your research is on the theme of this conference?
Sure. Well, I have a presentation that's about children's argumentation, but my presentation was not using video, but my current work is using the video. So yeah, I would love to share with you more. I noticed that someone raised their hand.
Yeah, let's see. If nobody has raised their hand, you can share some of your research.
Sure. I saw Fanny.
Should I say my question?
Yeah, it's your turn, please. Yeah,
thank you. I have a question. Do the students, like in the video for the, where the there was like the, I guess the flash flow or motor slide, were they trying to measure that? Were they only working during the school hours, or were they working outside of the school also? And a tie to that question is, were there any video about like the outside resources that they use? Maybe they have a family member that works in construction or has like knowledge about like moving this amount of dirt from one place to another and things like that.
Okay. Fanny, where are you from, so everybody can know?
Yes, I'm in Tucson, Arizona.
Okay, Tucson, Arizona, U.S.
Yes.
Okay, so you're kind of close to Ho Chi Minh. Okay. Anyways, they did most of the work. You know, I know the teacher. I don't know the students. Okay, I've met her in conference. So she's one of the teachers who go to conference. And she keep telling, I did not know anything about technology. And then I wrote an email to you, and I start answering to her and tell her, read this book and see this. And now she's my teacher of video. She makes videos much better than I do, and she, you know, is excellent. She used most of it in, and that's a public school, in a regular school, and she did most of it during mathematics hours. And she did have some extra hours in case of teachers who did not attend and she was there. So she would go to that class to do things. But that mudslide on the dam was really a tragedy in that whole area in the state of Minas Gerais. So everybody was interested in that. But I would say that the main resource that she got was her curiosity. She started asking everybody, and she was doing almost real calculus with 12-year-olds, you know, doing, right? And so, but yes, but she's, I would say, yeah, as a middle-class teacher, so she was, you know, probably knows engineers and a lot of people who kind of help, but there were many kids whose parents gave information as well. So this was something interesting on that. Thanks for your question, Fanny. Did I answer it, or is there some part missing?
No, you did answer it. Thank you.
Thank you, Fanny. And your work is not on videos, is it?
Well, I work with families. That's why my question was oriented as towards like the students' families and what they can learn from home and bring that to the school. So so I want to do something about videos, students making videos of their homes and what they do, the math they do inside their homes and things like that. So that's one thing that attracted me about this talk.
Oh, okay. And this brings me to the, I don't know whether you're here when I put this, but I'll put here the link of this paper, this Educational Studies in Mathematics paper. It's for free. And it's and it talks about the role of homes in teaching and learning during the pandemic. It's just the beginning, so it's setting a research agenda that I think could be well explored by researchers like you, Fanny, who maybe could see the different homes, how do they show, how they not show, and maybe connecting with the perspective of Ho Chi Minh, of emotional things, people who don't have any problems of showing. My former dining room, that's now is a mix of an office and I'm dining somewhere, but people who just don't want to show it, you know, and they just go and, you know, turn off the camera or they put something else because, you know, each person is each person. So this is something that I think it's more and more now an important issue, the role of homes. I think it became so clear again during the pandemic, how different homes can make a difference in mathematics education, in education in general. I'm lost. Are there other questions or comments? If not, I'll ask for Ho Chi Minh. I do have more PowerPoint here, but I like these more interactive things here.
Do you want to share your PowerPoint or it's okay now?
No, it's better if there are more comments, if Ho Chi Minh wants to say a little bit about his research, because I'm already connecting his interest to Fanny's. So this kind of thing could be more interesting. And if other people who are there and want to ask questions in Mandarin, I'll need your help, Sophie.
Okay, I will do that.
Uh, Hello, Dr. Sorry. Okay. So how did you evaluate? I mean, I like those videos you're sharing. They're doing the mud of the sea. And I can see the students are putting a lot of effort into making the videos and also the teachers. But how did you evaluating the procedures, the process, I mean, during the whole active? Thank you very much.
Very good question. Maybe I'll ask Sophie to write the name of the person who asked the question here in the chat. But in any case, your question is very, very good. And there are two types of evaluation. One is the evaluation for the festival. Another one is if I'm evaluating that as a teacher in a regular classroom, okay? So Kinzu, I hope I have pronounced your name correctly, but Kinzu, I think that if I am in the classroom, I start evaluating videos in my pre-calculus class for biology majors, not online, face-to-face. And I would ask the students to make videos, and it was very hard to make videos 12 years ago, 10 years ago, you know, even for young university students. So, but they did. And in the beginning, I have to say that I would say everything is good. So was almost a 10 for everybody. But it was 10%, you know, or 20% sometimes of the grade. But then I kept developing the amount of work. So that was the main thing. And I would interview them sometimes, the amount of work they have done. Second, whether there was some mathematics connected to the thing that they could have explored. And third, if it was connected to what we agreed on in that class. In the festival, and now I think the festival is teaching to the classroom, we're evaluating three things: the quality of mathematics, the creativity, and technical issues. So for instance, now the technical issue of the translation here, it's excellent, it's a 10. In the first 10 minutes of our session, the quality was no good. So then the sound, the video would lose some points. So that's the main part. It was like technical issues, creativity, and mathematics. And we're asking TV actress and actors with, together with math teachers, to be in the jury so that we can not have only video classes, you know, but we can have creativity. So we have some with arts that they make, for instance, parables, and they make all kind of things with animations and that, and connecting to some traditional arts, showing that you could have painted those with using geometric forms. Oh, not a problem. Everybody has internet problems. And so it's the new part of it. So I hope I have answered your question, Kizu, and thank you very much for it. See, I have worked with videos now in evaluation in classrooms for more than 10 years. And Newton Dominguez, who asked, who had the thesis reported by Juliana, was my undergraduate student and taught me a lot too about how to analyze and see videos.
Well, thank you very much for your answer. Thank you.
Thank you, Kizu.
Actually, Sophie has a new question I want to discuss with you. Yeah, so actually a lot of like theories are mentioned in this presentation, and like multiple representation theory, which is really like related to my doctoral studies, and also like multimedia. And I found that Juliana like used the humans with media, and also there is a multimodality, like these three theories. So I just wondering like, what about like connections between these three theories, and what are the distinct features of each theory, and how these theories are connected? And also I realized there is like a meaning multiplier in the presentation. So I just wondering like, how it comes to the meaning multiplier, like the progression of this theoretical work.
Hello.
I think Professor Borba, probably like due to the internet interruption, I guess he may log in very quick, and yeah. So let's wait for Professor Borba to log in again. Yeah, that's the magic of the internet. We can't predict any. Or Liliane, do you want to share something like about multiplier, meaning multiplier?
Hello?
Hello.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, now we can hear you.
Okay, sorry. Anna, was I heard your question. Was about the connections of the different frameworks, right?
Yes.
Okay, and so maybe it is a good time to answer your questions and maybe try to share here. Let's see if I security. Okay, let me see if I can share here a little bit of that. Now I'll share in a little while. Oops. Oh, now, okay. Now it's back again. In any case, so social semiotics, activity theory, and the view of technology based on the notion of humans with media. Okay. I think that's your question. How are they connected? And it's very important to have that in a research methodology workshop, because the procedures are part of your answer, but they also express your theoretical view. So that's very important that you know these perspectives. Sophie, this is an excellent question. It's actually part of papers I've been writing. This one I put on educational studies there, but also other ones and a new book maybe that's coming out. But it's my earlier research was on multiple representations, in particular of the notion of functions. So I use coordination of algebra with tables and graphs. Research, when I start coming into video, I saw, geez, that's very, you know, it's very limited. And Liliane, who was my main partner with this kind of research, saw, yes, that's good, and she liked that. But then we knew that we need something else. And there was different version of semiotics, but we liked social semiotics because it would help us to analyze and show the context, such as the context of homes, like this one that I just talked to Fanny a minute ago. So social semiotics expands the notion of multiple representations and put musics and put other things, and is more coherent to analyze videos. So Liliane and other members of the team, Vanessa Oexler and others, they analyze videos frame by frame. And Marcelo Souza, another Marcelo too. So they analyze, you know, just little by little. So this was important and was one notion. But as I was doing the research on multiple representations and all that, I made part at Cornell University in the United States of a team of researchers who were developing a software for Apple's for Apple computers that had to do with functions. And at the same time, I could see that designers and us would think of one thing, but students would transform that technology. But I could also see that that technology would transform them. So that's how I came to the idea, oh, there is an intershaping relationship. There is a, you know, technology shapes Marcelo, and Marcelo shapes technology in different ways than they were designed for. And this is how it comes, the notion of humans with media, that I should be considering different humans like Liliane, Juliana, and I, but also different media. So different media, different mathematics. We make demonstration because we have cheap paper, and now we have cheap screen, you know? But so that's the kind of thing that we keep doing. So this is the very notion of the notion of humans with media is telling. Knowledge is produced collectively by humans and by different media. And this different media give the historical aspect of it, of how this knowledge is expressed. And this very notion, dear Sophie and colleagues, was the one that it came, it was based too on many, I can talk more about the base, but I'll talk just about one of them, on Tikhomirov, a Russian psychologist who was Vygotsky's student. And then he is from like the first generation of activity theory. And so we keep doing that and we say, oh, there's collective humans with video now, because we make one video and we put on YouTube or on TikTok or whatever, and then everybody's using that video again to make mathematics and to communicate to others. So social semiotics, very good to understand videos. The notion of humans with media allows you to tell how the mathematics can be different with video, because it changed with paper, it changed orally, you know, it changed when, or even in Greece, when there was a little paper available for them. But it did not answer questions such as the ones about the motives, you know, about what made people make a video, like the first question asked. So that's the question that it takes us to activity theory, and to have, maybe if Juliana can find that picture there, Juliana, with the internet bumping, and if you can share with us, this would be nice. Because then with that notion, we can somehow come back and analyze how the video is changing different parts of the activity system and how the aim, the product may change. The objective of one student may be one, but not another. For somebody else, it could be another one. I'm not seeing anything. Can you, did you try or are you trying to? Okay. It did not show yet. Juliana was about to, but somehow. Oh, so you just put the video here. Oh, yeah. But I was thinking of maybe if you can share the screen. If you can share the screen here with us. So we just stay here. There's the link there if you want to have it afterwards. But what I would say is to synthesize, Sophie. So we have social semiotics for looking at the video. And we have this view now of humans with media that we transform in the third generation of activity theory, in which the subjects can be the internet sometimes. Oh, but the internet is also an artifact. But the internet can also be a community, like we are now in the community internet. And internet is changing the rules as well of what we're seeing. But the main part is that the object of an activity system may be different. So participating in a video for one student is one thing, but for another group of students, a different thing. So that was the idea, my friend now, dear Sophie. Did I answer your question, Sophie?
Yeah, thank you so much. And I'm really like impressed by one sentence you mentioned, like Borba shapes a technology and the technology shapes Borba. It's like, for me, it's more like a bidirectional connections, like between you and technology and like the interactions between them. And also for my doctoral dissertation is about bidirectional connections in textbooks. And it makes me feel like kind of like the similar feeling. And thanks for your answer to my questions.
No, and let me add, there is many papers, if you're interested, Dan and Juliana and I can send to you on the intershaping relationship and on things like this. And if some of them are still in Portuguese, we'll manage to make at least 60% translation to any, and then if it is of interest, we make a real translation, just so you can understand. But yes, I think that technology does constitute us as humans. And we use technology and we shape technology in different ways. So there's a dialectic that somehow keep evolving from the early tools, from the early technology we have. And now with digital technology and textbook, as in your research, which are more and more digital and less papers, it's also gonna be shaping students and shaping education. So there are some people trying to use this view to analyze textbooks. I don't know whether they're gonna be doing that or not, but I'll be very glad to help you and whoever is here, if they interest in this view and wanna develop further.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome, Sophie.
If you have a question for our online audience, you can raise your hands and I can unmute you and you can post your questions. And for our on-site audience, 大家有问题可以举手, 中文也OK, 我可以翻译。
And if Juliana or Liliane wants to say something, they can either say in Portuguese, and I'll translate. And then we have a multilingual seminar, a real international. Oh, there is another question from.
Hi, it's me again.
Okay.
My understanding, I mean, my knowledge about Brazil educational is very limited. So I don't know if you please, can you generate talking about how mathematical education is about over there? Especially on primary, maybe, because I'm a teacher in primary school. So would you please generate talking about the situation over there?
Yes, I can talk about situation in Brazil. And also a little bit about during the pandemic. During the pandemic, most schools pretty much stopped for more than 6 months. Most public schools have been stopped for more than a year and a half. And some private schools with a lot of pressure have resumed classes. But with quite a toll on teachers who got ill with COVID. Maths education in general, we have from kids from 7 years old to 11, they have one teacher who does not have special education in mathematics education. Okay, so it's a general teacher to teach all the subjects. Some schools, public or private, when it gets to the age of 10 or 11, they start having two teachers, one for science and math, and another one for social science and Portuguese, and sometimes foreign language, which is usually English. So these would be the regular scenario. We do have, if you then take a look at the paper, talk about social inequality of homes, but we do have social inequality, a huge inequality in schools. So that generates more social inequality. So maybe Juliana went to a very nice school when she was young, and Marcelo to a very poor in terms of resources, in terms of cleanliness or things like this. So it's very unequal, okay? But there is quite a bit of good research and collaboration of teachers and researchers in terms of developing work for kids. So in these international tests, Brazil does not do very good. But depending on how you divide Brazil, Brazil does very good. So the private schools would be in a good block, and some of the good public schools would be very well positioned as well. Okay? So it's very unequal, everything. So that would be maybe the main part that I could say.
Oh, thank you very much.
You're welcome, King Zong. Mr. Zhu.
Perfect.
I have to learn a little bit of Mandarin. Yeah.
Really? Just have a cup of coffee and bring a piece of cake? Because you're in the kitchen, I guess.
Because what?
Because I think like in the background, it should be like some food there. I don't know.
Uh-huh. And so maybe now I'll put the, let's see if I put something else here. Since I talked so much about this paper, which is from educational studies, maybe I would like to share them a little bit with you here and some of the things that I believe it's a little bit Sophie, of a theoretical framework coming to critical mathematics education that's not on this view of technology and on these other views at the moment. Oh, okay. Can you see the PowerPoint?
Yeah, we can see the PowerPoint.
Qualitative research, okay, because I can't see it, so then it's funny. But anyways, there is one thing that I did not say in the PowerPoint, nor Giuliano or Liliane, but is the relationship between theoretical frameworks and research methodology. So I'm gonna talk a little bit that depending on the theoretical frameworks you have, you may have a kind of, you're gonna see that these theoretical frameworks are more appropriate, they call almost for qualitative methods. And that's the same to the other way around. Some qualitative methods somehow call for certain frameworks. So it's like an intershaping relationship, if you like, Sophie, between these two things. And so I think that when we have students as protagonists producing videos, we do change the classroom. And if we do change the relationship between teachers and students in the classroom, we may have also to be changing the kind of research we may do. So this notion here that you like too much, so I had two or three extra PowerPoints here in case of your interest. So I think it's more of this one here. There is a view of cognition and more, not just only of cognition, in which it's a view of emotion too, it's a view of knowledge. And on this book that I showed you already during the video by Springer, keep evolving since then, and we keep doing other stuff in this idea. Now, the main part is that we're going over to see how non-digital technology, how things, do you know there is a big discussion among biologists whether virus is a living being or whether it's a thing and oscillates between them. So I took the view of things because computer is a thing, but computer is a thing impregnated of humanity. We like Zoom because Zoom has this design. We don't like the other Zoom because the other Zoom does not have one thing. So I like another Zoom that I use because when I'm presenting, I can see not on this other screen here, I can also see here what people are seeing. But look, a virus also only become dangerous as the SARS-CoV-2 when, you know, it touch impregnates with human and transform human. And one virus, one thing that we cannot see, we need 1,000 of these glasses here to be able to see a virus. We just go and when we look, we can somehow see that little thing transformed the life of humanity during this year. So now I'm more and more with humans with media things and homes, as I have talked to Fanny and to other people. And this is the shocking picture. This is the city of São Paulo. Can you see that if I'm having online teaching during the pandemic, the kids who live here have a different opportunity than the ones who live here, right? This is in the city of São Paulo. Here you have 4-6 square meters for probably 6-8 people living here. Here you have, you know, 200-300 meters, you know, apartments, 400 meters, square meters, sorry, apartments for maybe four people. So this is very different to study here and to connect than here. And probably here, the connection is better. And you have one computer in each room. And here you have one mobile phone, you know, just for everybody. So this, I'm more and more extending, Sophie, the notion of not only humans with media as the agent for knowledge, but also humans with media with things. And more, I think this, the concept of humans with media, this idea can serve the role of discuss social inequality. And back to Mr. Zhu, we have no research for early grades in online mathematics education. So, because all the research was for university students. So now we would have to be studying now reports of how mothers can help their kids differently. So with the social inequality of my country, of Brazil, so of course, if I had little kids, I don't have little children now, it would be very different, the capacity I have to help, because I'm a PhD. But there are many parents, they have kid, and they just went to school for 3 years, and they left school because they had to work. So how do I equalize that? The school was one place to equalize that with good teachers, but now we don't have this possibility. So we need more research for this. And this is what I just told you now. And we must be preparing for other crises, because it looks like that we can have other ones. And more than that, I think that we don't have to be acritical of technology, because also was a lot of Marcelo strips that somehow allow us to have this kind of passing a virus to everybody and having these other kind of crises. But technology was also the one who somehow enabled us to have some kind of mathematics education during the pandemic. And we have to be talking more and more about this notion of domestication, that when we use a technology, when we use videos, when we use any software of mathematics, we have to know that if we don't transform the way we think mathematical activities, we may be domesticating it, just using utilizing it with less, with practice from the old media. So this is part of the notion of humans with media to help us with trying to see that different media, new rules, new things, new change, everything. And as I mentioned before, we do bring new political issues with capital P in terms of trying to have more equality, equality between men and women, between races, and between poor and rich, and things like this, in order to have an education for all. So anyway, so this is part of the idea. So maybe now you have more comments or doubts or other questions. And I can just...
I guess Paul has a question.
Yeah, and... may I now speak? Hi, guys. Thank you, Sophie. This is Paul Des, who's a PhD student from the Philippines, and it's nice to see participants from other countries, from other areas. Can you hear me clearly, Dr. Marcelo?
Right. Yes.
Yeah. I just would like to thank you for sharing again the framework of activity theory. I think this is my second time experiencing such framework. The first time was when I observed in a dissertation defense in our university, which featured the same framework. I am actually working, working on a curriculum modification framework for our Filipino deaf and hard of hearing learners. And last year, because of the pandemic devastated my plans for my data gathering, because my methods were done with face-to-face classes at the back of our minds, we were supposed to observe face-to-face classes, but since the pandemic has prevented us to do so, because all of our schools here in the Philippines have adopted this virtual platform. Let me take this opportunity to ask, no, Mr. Marcelo, Dr. Marcelo, do you have like any idea aside from perhaps video that I could ways perhaps to gather data? My aim of my study is on coming up with a curriculum modification framework that would benefit our deaf and hard of hearing learners that are being catered by our mainstream classes. Aside from videos, perhaps, because I need to tweak my methodology so that it would fit into our plan of making it compatible for virtual platform. Do you have like other ways or methodologies in mind that you can suggest, Dr. Marcelo, for my data gathering? Thank you.
Thank you, Paul. And then I would like to tell me again, what is the name of the university where you saw this kind of framework being used?
But Ateneo de Manila University.
University?
Ateneo de Manila University.
Okay. Manila University. Okay. Very good. So if it is in English, then please send it to my email afterwards. Okay.
Okay.
Let me tell you one thing, Paul. I recently attended in a committee of a doctoral student. He's already a doctor now. Well, he should be. He's just handing in. Actually, was in the university where Juliana studied as an undergraduate. So it's a guy called Albino, and he just made something that it's available for blind students who can. They can read a site, okay? And so how he does that? He has some computer thing, a new thing that becomes a new humans with media, that when the person touches the screen, he happens something for him to or her to listen to it. And somebody asks about deaf students. So all I can say is that he said there are people developing this. So I think there are some kind of technology now, for deaf, that if you're talking about young kids would be a problem, because somehow if they cannot read and if they cannot hear, I don't know how the communication would be, but definitely through image would be one part. So, but this is where I can tell you, but I think it's a very open question now. All the research methodology we have to do, to develop research when we are in people's home. Let's suppose this is a home of a student and Marcelo is an 8-year-old. So it's very complicated to put an 8-year-old sitting down here to talk to you. That does not exist. So, but let's suppose you're talking with a 12-year-old. Well, but he still has the all the problems with the, he's at his home or at her home. So how to deal with that, with the whole issue with mothers and everything else? So I think there are many open questions about how to develop research with ethics in this online pandemic education. We call it panic gog instead of, you know, instead of pedagogy, we call it panic gog. Panic pedagogy, and put it together in one word in this article by Engelbrecht, was the thing that we have to create all of a sudden to do. So I think we're going to have to do a panic research methodology as well, you know, panic log in terms of developing things. It's really hard, your question, Paul. And I don't think we have now, and especially with deaf kids, and very, very complicated, you know, to, and if they can't read. So if they can't read, then so it must be some kind of videos with some kind of sign language in a way that they can communicate. I did not help you, but at least
you're making me reflect, Doc. it's still nice hearing from you, Doc. I guess aside from document analysis and the actual observation, hopefully we can come up with something more concrete so that we can actually arrive at a curriculum modification framework that that we intend to have in the end.
Yeah, let's hope so. But but I'm not quite sure how to develop that. So, Juliana wants to say something or no? No. Okay.
Thank you, Doc Marcelo. Thank you.
No, thank you, Paul, for your question. And it's a doubt. It's not a easy one. I think it's a main problem in people who have a special need, who are deaf, who are blind, are even more distant from regular education in this kind of online pandemic education.
Thank you so much. So for our online audience, if you want to post a question, you can raise your hand and I will unmute you when it's your turn to speak. And also for our audience here, 大家还是可以中文问问题，然后我也可以翻译。
Okay, I'm learning some Mandarin at least.
Really?
I'm trying to see. You know, she's inviting them to ask questions. No, but I can't.
I have another. It's not a question. It's like, it's still a question. So in the video, like the mud of sea. So I was very impressed of all the mathematical thinking and all the mathematics like students do in this project. And from my perspective, it's more like an interdisciplinary project. And the students, like in this process, they need to do the mathematics and like use the modeling and utilize their knowledge in geometry and like do a lot of like measurement and, you know, calculate the scale or like do the calculations and the conversions and things like that. So I just wondering, like, are there any other interdisciplinary projects, like probably like similar to the Mud of Sea or others? And how would you like come out with this kind of project? And it's like a regular project or it's very innovative in your context? And Yeah, will you consider like develop other interdisciplinary projects like targeting students' mathematical thinking? Yeah, things like that.
Thank you, Sophie. I think you're asking fantastic questions. I think you should come to Brazil and study here because you know you're really coming. Juliana already find a place for you to stay, and first, like the. You're right, the Mud of Sea and many other videos, they are very interdisciplinary. You could say that Mud of Sea is an example of STEM at the early grades, or it is an example of STEAM because you also have arts. The kids were, you know, cutting that and making models and making all that. So you have mathematics, you have a lot of physics there. You have a lot of emotion there. You know, there are relatives of those kids who are still disappeared, you know, in the mud of sea. So you have a lot of things there. And the festival is one part when Juliana said there, it's one thing. We put the site here. I'll ask Juliana to put it again here, the site of the festival. It's a project that's together research and outreach work and teaching. So how is that? So in this site there, you have 700 videos like the Mud of Sea, okay? And about this, 600-700 videos. We're gonna count it soon again because we just had a new batch coming in for the fifth festival. So we are creating this annually as a way of creating culture. But we know already that there are many other projects like this going on. In parallel to us, there is a student video. This one is not only for teachers. Ours is for teachers and students. So there's a student videos for all kinds of subjects, which started in the southern state of Brazil. So there is quite a bit of things like this going on, but the school is still very traditional and very disciplinary. So the video is a window that we can do. So when Liliane is teaching linear algebra, if she asks her students to make a video, then it's disciplinary, but maybe the video opens for connecting linear algebra with the other subject. So if Juliana is now, she's teaching a class now for pre-service mathematics teachers in their final grades. So she's using videos to make them connect mathematics with other subjects using the knowledge she learned in the project, and at the same time, she's teaching a lot of things to us about different experience. So there is a few schools who are already starting local festivals. So the dissertation of Vanessa Oexler, she developed festivals in the city in southern Brazil in different schools. So mathematics education in Brazil is very disciplinary. But we are trying to bring STEM and STEAM, science, technology, engineering, arts, and mathematics to early grades. And we believe that videos, and not that videos should be the only thing, is videos with regular testing, videos with also asking for reading books. And I tell people that many of the videos in the festival are from teachers and students who read books and have ideas and then make them into different videos. So yes, Sophie, it is very interdisciplinary. And I don't know whether that's the same in China or not, but in Brazil, many people who write about interdisciplinary, many people support it, but very few people practice it. And so we are trying to practice that in our research group And we are having some of these videos, which are, you know, students showing to their parents, showing to their friends. So we have in mathematics being taught to others like soccer, like football. So this could be a transformation for people in the image of mathematics, which is a theme of part of our research. Okay? So I hope I have answered this question as well, Sophie, and convince you to come to Brazil to study more.
Yeah, so I have two more small questions. So is like interdisciplinary practice or studies or courses supported or required by the curriculum, national curriculum standards in Brazil, or is just like the local practice or the practice like supported by the school? And my second question would be like, so you mentioned like a few schools will host their local festivals or participate in the local festivals. I just wondering about the interdisciplinary practice. It's like supported by the public school or the private school, or yeah, it's in the most of them are they in the secondary level or elementary level?
Okay. Yeah. Most of them, let me ask by the last question, most of these videos have been done by more by older kids after 12 and by future teachers and now by teachers. So we are inducing that. This is not in the national curriculum. We are changing our national curriculum. I don't want to get into that now, but it's just some change with calls for the use of digital technology, but nothing specific about videos, okay? So there is many things about using softwares and using things like this. But there is nothing in the national curriculum that's against the use of videos. So it's much more something about implementing. And our festival is very national. We just had a paper approved now in a Korean journal that we are published showing the history of the festivals and the idea of festival because they were interested in that. And believe me, there are, you know, Brazil has 27 states, 26 plus the federal district, our Washington, D.C., for people who know the USA, it's, I think we've been having, we had people from 23 states, you know, in the five festivals. So very few states have not been there yet. So it's growing and it's becoming more, and it was gonna grow more if it were not for the pandemic, because many teachers have difficulty in helping their students with the videos doing that online with much easier. There are many reports of them telling that. So yes, Althea, that's my answer for you here at 12:15 in the morning in Brazil. That was my latest talk ever in my life. I never gave a talk so late in my life.
Thank you so much.
But I really would like to be in Shanghai, so I'm going to have to be next time. Mm-hmm. I had everything planned to get to know your country.
Looking forward to that. And I will probably like take you like walking around the ECNU campus and also the Shanghai.
Hey, okay.
Other questions?
Comments? You can also share your experience. You can tell to people in Mandarin as well that if they want to share a little experience they have of research in the last 17 minutes, 16 minutes we have, would be a good idea. So I get to know some of the research that are being developed by people who are in the audience.
Mm-hmm. 大家也可以聊一下自己的研究，然后有问题的话，就是自己的研究也可以跟老师讨论。然后如果是中文的话，我尽力翻译。对，好。
Oh, somebody, yes.
Hello, Professor Borba.
Hello.
Yeah. Let me introduce myself. My name is Tommy from Indonesia. Yeah, Professor Borba. I have a question. Maybe I need some advice for my study, for my research, but quantitative research. Well, now in my country, Indonesia, right now, coronavirus has been 2 years and still ongoing, continue right now. And I want to prove or analyze about there is an effect about coronavirus pandemic to technological knowledge. About how COVID coronavirus pandemic make the teacher improve their technological knowledge. Can I using qualitative method for this analysis, or how to prove that coronavirus pandemic can improve the teacher's technological knowledge, Professor?
Oh, okay. So your name is Tony?
Yeah, again? My name is Tommy.
Okay, Tommy. Let me see first if I understood your question. I think that your question was, can I use qualitative methods to kind of show that the pandemic has made teachers improve their competence in using digital technology?
Sorry, Professor?
No, I just want to see if I understood your question. So can I try to rephrase for you?
Yeah.
Is your question like this? Can I use qualitative methods to show that the coronavirus made teachers more, make teachers smarter in using digital technology? Is this your research question? Yes.
Yeah, I want to prove that coronavirus pandemic have an effect to teachers' technological knowledge, Professor.
Okay. So I think that the answer is yes and no, but it's more yes. So let me tell you how. If we go to the first. Let me see if I find the original PowerPoint, the one I showed you in the video. And I just found it here. No, this is a different one. There are many PowerPoints here. And okay, I found it here. So Tommy, there is a... and cause and effect, okay. There is one thing here that I can share with you. There is this little part here about axioms of qualitative research. So one difference is that maybe the word prove, as we have a mathematical proof in mathematics, would not be used, because the knowledge that we construct from qualitative research is it's not exactly if this then there, and we acknowledge there are influence by humans in it. But I think Tommy, that you should use interviews, online interviews, and this we have already developed research on how to do that. We know how to do that, to ask teachers about their experience with using technology during this. I'm sure that you're gonna find many teachers, or all of them, telling what they learn. But maybe Liliane learned something different than Juliana, than I. I learn a lot, and I, you know, I study this, and I learn many things just using digital technology that I did not know before from online. So I think that actually the best thing for your research questions are qualitative methods. You are not gonna have you're not gonna have, let me see if this is better now here. You're not gonna have a proof, but you're gonna have a grounded theory, a theory grounded on your interviews. So this is the main idea. You'd be using interviews, and there are techniques to analyze and to get some of the main points so that you'd have an answer to your question, which I think it's a very important research question. And it should be developed. I like your research, and I think maybe we should be developing that in China, in Brazil, in Indonesia, and in the US, in Philippines. I think those are the countries that are here so far that I know of. So thank you for your question. I hope I have answered. If not, I'll try again.
Yeah, Professor Borba, how many teachers will I need to interview for if I use this quantitative method?
Okay, this you asking wonderful questions. Very good methodology, because it's the type, is the size of the sample. So the size of the sample, if you are doing quantitative research, there is already a formula from statistics, and we know that, and we use that, for instance, to generate the vaccines that we're using now. In qualitative research, the best way of doing that is for you to know when the answer is starting becoming the same. So you would start with interviewing Juliana, and Juliana gave you one kind of answer, and you start dividing Juliana's. I'm using Juliana as an example, okay, as a teacher in Philippines, and then Juliana go and give you an answer, and you divide her answer in four or five things that emerged from that. Then you interview Liliane, which confirms two or three of those things, but not two others. But also Liliane put a different thing. And then you interview Fanny, and you interview Sophie. And then at the end, you're starting to become about six or so, and nothing else different comes more, okay? So that's time to stop. And the other thing is about if you're doing a master, if you're doing a PhD, that also depends, because usually you have time and you have scholarship. So a qualitative research may start like any kind of research in one dissertation and ends on another. So we should be doing things in articulated different dissertations. But I'm sure you're gonna do qualitative research now, because I can see that you're very interested, and you're asking so many good questions, because I already know you're going there.
Oh. Okay, thank you, Professor Borba, for your suggestion and advice. So I hope we can continue to discuss about my research after this conference, Professor Borba.
Yes, in this book here, it's a classic, 1985, you know, Naturalistic Inquiry, you know, Ivona Lincoln and Igor Guba. And it's going to tell you a lot, and this one is in English, so with it's really gonna help you in terms of doing in terms of discussing the size and the purpose. Of course, for instance, you're not going to do a random sampling. You're going to interview the teachers who are actually teaching during the pandemic. The ones who decided the school decided they should stay at home, you're not going to interview them because they are out of your realm of interest. Okay? But thank you. It's a wonderful, fantastic question.
Okay. Once again, thank you for Professor Borba.
Thank you.
Any other questions online and on site? Probably it's our time for the last question. Okay.
Hello, sir. It's my honor yes. to participate in your lecture. My name is Linda. Maybe because I came here late, I just have one question. I'm planning to do some research on supplementary tutoring. Maybe in other countries, it is called shadow education. In China, it is very popular for K to 12 students. And now, as a parent, as a teacher, I want to know something from the perspective of parents, why they are so glad to choose after school tutoring for their children. And may I use the qualitative research method? May I do some interviews or in-depth interviews to the parents? And I want to get the conclusion about why they have the intention to choose shadow education. I want to make some reasonable theories for future parents to make good choice for their children. Because parents play an important role in shadow education. And it's so popular in China now. It is our summer vacation. As far as I know, almost over 90% of the upper level primary students take part in shadow education. And now my question is that whether can I use the qualitative research to do further study? Thank you, sir, that's all.
Thank you for your question. And I think the answer is yes. And very similar to the one I gave to the teacher. I think it's very important for you to interview these parents, and then you could start mapping, showing them a little bit different, how do things work, and what are the patterns, what this group of parents thinks and whatever. And maybe the parents who read this kind of research, then they would be interested and say, oh, I'm more this kind of parents, and I'm more this other kind. I work 12 hours, so I do not have this time during the summer, or I have more flexibility, so I can do that more in the shadow education. And of course, it depends on the education level of the parents, okay? But very interesting, and yes, would be qualitative research for sure.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. That's all for my question.
Thank you, and thank you all of you and Sophie for the questions.
Thank you so much. And now we reach the end of the workshop, and many thanks again to Professor Borba, Dr. Liliane, and Juliana for bringing us such a great workshop and interactive sessions. So if the audience have any further questions about this workshop, and you could send the email to Professor Borba. And our workshop today ends here. And the next session of Early Career Researcher Day, the journal plenary session, will start at 1:30 p.m. Beijing time. And see you then. Thank you so much, Professor Borba.
And thank you, Sophie. Thank you for organizing. Thank you for your wonderful questions. And thank you all for that. It was very, very nice being in Shanghai, even if I'm not in Shanghai. But next time.
Okay, see you.
See you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you.